Good afternoon. Welcome to St. Peter's 5 o'clock service on Saturday afternoon. We are so glad you're with us. We invite you to like and share this video so that our friends and those in the world who may be looking for some spiritual sustenance right now can enjoy this time with us. We have as our preacher this evening, Deacon Bob Nelson, and as our lectors, our sisters, Fran Friesen and Chris Miller, they're with us this afternoon as well. Kevin Martin is our technical support. Thank you so much, Kevin, for that. Mother Paige is on vacation, kind of a staycation, and we wish her rest and restoration during this time away. Our service will begin after the ringing of the bell. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Please join me in saying great and wonderful from a New Zealand prayer book. Great and wonderful are your deeds, O Lord God the Almighty. Just and true are your ways, O Sovereign of the nations. Who shall not revere and praise your name, O Lord, for you alone are holy. All nations shall come and worship in your presence, for your just dealings have been revealed. To the one who is seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor, glory and might forever and ever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, the protector of all who trust in you, without whom nothing is strong, nothing is holy, increase and multiply upon us your mercy, that with you as our ruler and guide, we may so pass through things temporal, that we lose not the things eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be?" Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were lovely, and Rachel was graceful and beautiful. Jacob loved Rachel, so he said, "I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter, Rachel." Laban said, "It is better that I give her to you than that I should give her to any other man. Stay with me." So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, "Give me my wife that I may go in to her, for my time is completed." So Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening, he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and he went in to her. Laban gave his maid Zilpah to his daughter Leah to be her maid. When morning came, it was Leah, and Jacob said to Laban, "What is this you have done to me? Did I not serve with you for Rachel? Why then have you deceived me?" Laban said, "This is not done in our country, giving the younger before the firstborn. Complete the week of this one, and we will give you the other also in return for serving me another 7 years." Jacob did so and completed her week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as a wife. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join us in reading Psalm 105. Give thanks to the Lord and call upon his name.
Make known his deeds among the peoples.
Sing to him, sing praises to him.
And speak of all his marvelous works.
Glory in his holy name.
Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice.
Search for the Lord and his strength.
Continually seek his face.
Remember the marvels he has done.
His wonders and the judgments of his mouth.
O offspring of Abraham, his servant.
O children of Jacob, his chosen.
He is the Lord our God.
His judgments prevail in all the world.
He has always been mindful of his covenant.
The promise he made for 1,000 generations.
The covenant he made with Abraham.
The oath that he swore to Isaac.
Which he established as a statute for Jacob.
An everlasting covenant for Israel.
Saying, To you will I give the land of Canaan,
to be your allotted inheritance.
Alleluia.
A reading from Paul's letter to the church in Rome. The Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus put before the crowds another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then, in his joy, he goes and sells all he has and buys the field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, he drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out his treasure what is new and what is old. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Well, this is the third Sunday where the parables of Jesus are the focus of the Gospel readings. The Reverend Martha and Nancy Burnett, over the past two Sundays, helped us to understand that Jesus used parables to convey a spiritual meaning to an everyday situation. Those who heard the parables had to think and to accept or oppose Jesus' teaching. In our Gospel reading from Matthew today, Jesus gives us five parables to help us understand the kingdom of heaven. Now, in the Gospels of Mark and Luke, it's called the kingdom of God. Now, the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God are the same. Matthew, a Jew, writing to Jews, is reluctant to call God by name for fear of blasphemy. Thus, he uses the word heaven. Now, there's a quick test that I'd like to give you to see what you think about the kingdom of heaven. Now, don't worry, taking the test is voluntary and it's self-scored, and I won't even know your answers unless you take the time to email them to me. Here are the questions. What do these five parables have to do with the kingdom of heaven? When you think of the kingdom of heaven, what do you think? Can you describe heaven? Where is heaven? Again, what do these five parables have to do with the kingdom of heaven? When you think of the kingdom of heaven, what do you think? Can you describe heaven? Where is heaven? I think that most of us tend to think of heaven as a place, this place up there, a place at which we hope to arrive someday. It's a place that is tomorrow, not today. It's not in our future. It's not in our now. Well, I believe that Jesus teaches that the kingdom of heaven is both tomorrow and today. It's near. The kingdom of heaven is within us. We are a part of the kingdom of God when we let God be king over our lives. By our choices, we can create heaven on earth, or we can create our own hell on earth. The parables give us a snapshot from different perspectives of what the kingdom can be. For the most part, each parable relates to a single point. However, Nancy Burnett's sermon last week got me thinking about the pairing of the parables, particularly those that I think relate to the kingdom of heaven. One pair from today's reading includes the parables of the mustard seed and the yeast. They contrast small beginnings with their great potential. The size of our action to bring God into our lives is not as important as the act. God will do the work. A second pair includes the parables of the hidden treasure and the pearl. These parables have to do with objects of great value, which spark a great commitment. To me, there's nothing more valuable than God in my life. A great commitment to God is worth it. The parable of the fishing net and the parable of the weeds, which was read last week, emphasize the present openness of the kingdom to all who would enter, but also the great judgment that will come in the future, where the bad will be separated from the good. In this time of COVID-19, where we're sheltering at home and are restricting our travel outside, We can't safely meet together at St. Peter's to worship, even with face covering and safe distancing. That bothers many of us who expect to find the kingdom of God in holy buildings, in a cathedral, or in a special place like St. Peter's. I've been fortunate, as have many of you, to have been able to travel and to have visited and experienced a number of cathedrals, churches, and holy places. I've been able to experience the history, traditions, and worship of Christianity and other major religions of the world through architecture, art, literature, and music. I believe that God is in those places. I miss worshiping in community with you at St. Peter's. However, I've found God in other places, in nature, in the sunsets off our own coast, in the power of the waves, in the beauty of our deserts, in Zoom meetings with St. Peter's Breakfast Club, and even in the barking of my little dog who joins the neighborhood canine choir thinking they're protecting our homes. We're taught that we're made in God's image, male and female. I found that I can see God in people, in their acts of kindness, in their smiles and their tears, and in the sounds of my neighbor's children and in my grandkids' unencumbered love. In other words, I see God and the kingdom of heaven everywhere. God's will is done on earth as it is in heaven. The parables of the mustard seed and yeast suggest that the real kingdom may be found in humble places, simple acts, and among the least likely people. The smallest seed grows to the largest of shrubs and provides nesting sites for birds of the sky. It takes only a small quantity of yeast to leaven the flour needed to make a large quantity of bread. In Matthew's time, the disciples were encountering serious opposition. It didn't appear that the small movement of Christ's followers stood a chance against the forces arrayed against it by the Roman Empire. Yet here, 2,000 years later, the Roman Empire appears only in history books or in crumbling ruins, while billions of people around the world sing praises to Jesus. Like the mustard seed, the church has grown and provides sanctuary to many. But the church is not the kingdom of heaven. I think Jesus had his tongue firmly planted in his cheek when he called the mustard shrub a tree. Some of you may have been taught in elementary school, as was I, that the Spanish conquistadors planted mustard during their travels in Baja and Alta California to prove where they had been. Well, I've hiked and camped in some of that wild mustard. In my experience, it seldom grows very large, at most 8 to 10 feet tall, not high enough to be considered a tree. However, it is sufficient to provide shelter and shade for birds and small animals. I don't have firsthand experience with yeast, but I've read that the quantity of yeast needed to leaven 3 measures of flour is very small, and that that amount of leavened flour can produce enough bread to feed over 100 people. A tiny amount of yeast had then and still has the power to affect a large quantity of flour. But to me, the lesson here of the yeast is that we don't work in seclusion, but through involvement with others, through involvement with others throughout the world. Yeast can do its work only when it's mixed with a large quantity of raw dough. Otherwise, it has no use. So it is with those who would serve Jesus He calls us to go into the world, making disciples, baptizing, and teaching. We're called to do God's work with others, not alone. In most cases, we'll see only small evidence of the impact of our ministry on others. We will, however, see the full impact on ourselves. Now, was Jesus trying to teach the disciples through the mustard shrub and yeast that Christians should live expectantly? We've learned that God brings great things out of small beginnings. We should expect greatness, no matter how small is our initial action. I don't remember where it was or when I was told that in God's hands, small beginnings have the potential to grow so large as to shift the world on its axis. I have had a personal experience with a small beginning here at St. Peter's in the Showers of Blessing ministry. It's a ministry to persons who are homeless. Chris Miller, through her St. Peter's thrift shop, was providing clean clothes for persons in need, and she wondered why we couldn't let them use the shower in our education building. Julie Beth Hines brought the idea of a portable shower trailer to Father Joe Dervis when he was on staff here at St. Peter's. Joe asked me to help out, and fortunately, Bishop Mathis told me about the United Thank offering and the possibility of getting a grant through that. I wrote the grant, and that enabled the diocese to purchase the first shower trailer. When I got out of the way, laypersons took over operations of the ministry, and it has blossomed. Under the guidance of Alan Darcy, a second trailer has been purchased. Now, two trailers are operated by volunteers from several congregations: Episcopal, Roman Catholic, Lutheran, United Methodist, Baha'i, Jewish. The Jewish Family Services is now using it in their parking lot ministry. And then there's the non-affiliated volunteers. A good idea, started small, has grown to a major ministry to persons who are homeless in San Diego County. All of the parables call us to put God and the kingdom of heaven first in our lives. If we do that, we'll learn that what seems to be inconsequential may turn out to be most important in our lives. We'll find that we will receive blessing upon blessing and come to know the kingdom of heaven. The kingdom of God is here on earth as it is in heaven. Amen.
Our worship service continues with the story of our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. Let us say it together.
We believe in one God,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the People. Let us bring before the Lord the prayers that dwell in the heart of our community, responding,
Hear us, good Lord.
Spirit of wisdom, guide our tongues that we may speak of your marvelous works and rejoice in your bountiful gifts of forgiveness and new life. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
Righteous Governor, assist our leaders in discerning truth from deception and good from evil, so that they may exercise their office with integrity and be signs of hope to the people of our country and world. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
Source of strength, be with us in our weakness and help those who live in the dark corners of hopelessness, so that your love may reveal a greater light and dispel the fears that visit every heart. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
Bearer of our sins, remove the dust that blinds us to our shortcomings, so that admitting our wayward thoughts and actions, we may turn toward your mercy and receive your forgiveness. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
Creator of the universe, who brings us joy in the diversity of all that the eye can behold, make us ever grateful for the splendor of your making and ever protective of its fruits. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
Sun of righteousness, bring the dead into the brilliance of your light and make us thankful for the intercession of your saints. Let us pray.
Hear us, good Lord.
O most mighty and merciful God, in this time of great sickness, we flee to you for relief and comfort. Deliver us, we beseech you, from our peril. Give strength and skill to all those who minister to the sick. Prosper the means made use for their cure. Comfort those who mourn or who are in great financial distress. Endue our leaders with wisdom and courage. And grant that, perceiving how frail and uncertain our life is, we may apply our hearts to that heavenly wisdom which leads to eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
And before we exchange the peace, I just want to again welcome you. If you have little four-legged creatures in your house, as I do this moment, and maybe others around you who are two-legged, we wish and share the peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace. And before we say the birthday and anniversary prayer together, I would like to invite you who are present in cyberspace to put any names of those in your heart this week who are celebrating birthdays or anniversaries or other causes of celebration. And now would be the perfect time to pop those into the chat stream. And those of us who are worshiping together this day can share those prayers with you and lift up those whom you love and for whom you are praying. So let us say together the prayer, watch over thy servants, O Lord, as their days increase. Bless and guide them wherever they may be. Strengthen them when they stand. Comfort them when discouraged or sorrowful. Raise them up if they fall. And in their hearts may thy peace, which passeth understanding, abide all the days of their lives. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And we are at the moment in our service where we offer back to God all that God has given us, and out of all that God has given us with our offertory. You can make your offering to St. Peter's via text to give, and that number is on the screen, but it's 858-252-0622. You can also go to our website at stpetersdelmar.net/give and follow the prompts there, or you can drop a check in the mail to St. Peter's Episcopal Church, P.O. Box 336, Del Mar, California 92014. We thank you from the bottom of our heart for your ongoing generosity and support of the good work being done at St. Peter's, including the showers of blessings, as Deacon Bob most beautifully explained to us today. That ministry, there are others that are ongoing at the parish at this time. The Helping Hands ministry continues to operate with socially responsible distancing and care and delivery. And we are just eternally grateful for your generosity. Thank you. Let us with gladness present the offerings and oblations of our life and labor to God. And in gratitude, all things come of thee, O Lord.
And of thine own have we given thee.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
And let us say together the general thanksgiving from a New Zealand prayer book that is found at page 9 of your bulletin. God, our Creator, our Center, our Friend, we thank you for our good life, for those who are dear to us, for our dead, and for all who have helped and influenced us. We thank you for the measure of freedom we have and the extent to which we control our lives. And most of all, we thank you for the faith that is in us, for our awareness of you and our hope in you. Keep us, we pray you, thankful and hopeful and useful until our lives shall end. Amen. I'll offer just a little different blessing today. May the God of peace sanctify you entirely. May your spirit and soul and body be kept complete and blameless at the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. And the blessing of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and those you love today and always. Amen. And I would like to take a moment to highlight very quickly just a couple of announcements. The first is with Mother Paige on vacation. This week, there is no time for Mother Paige tomorrow afternoon. Well, for those of you who are on here on Monday at 3:00, that will resume the following Monday. So no time with Mother Paige this coming Monday. Also, just want to direct your attention to our website, the stpetersdelmar.net website. I'm delighted to tell you that we have a brand new web page that is up and running, with resources, with a blog post that I have written about the parish's journey to doing the sacred ground circles as part of the wider work in the Episcopal Church of Racial Reconciliation. And you will find that under the Ways to Grow tab in the website, on the webpage. So invite your attention to that. Follow the links. If you have any questions or feedback, you're welcome to email me at manderson@stpetersdelmar.net. Also, it is time to register for Moms Uplifting Mothers, Mothers Uplifting Mothers. So basically, Mums, M-U-M-S. If you have a young one or young ones and would like to share in the sisterhood of raising your young ones with other sisters in the faith, we invite you to stpetersdelmar.net/mums, and you can register there. Any questions, please email Sarah Holmes at sholmes, that's sholmes at stpetersdelmar.net. So most of all, thank you for being here. And Deacon Bob, would you dismiss us?
Let us go forth in the name of Christ.
Thanks be to God.